Oh, welcome to the video on Wuthering Heights by Emily Bronte. This is one of the most wild, passionate texts in English literature, and it is a text that I like very much. This is the Top Withens Farm in Haworth, in Yorkshire, in England, and this is said to have been the inspiration for the Earnshaw House, that is Wuthering Heights. Emily Bronte, the author, is the second sister of Charlotte Bronte. She lived from 1818 to 1848. 1818 is the year in which Mary Shelley's Frankenstein was published and Emily Bronte was born. Charlotte, Emily, and Anne were three of the five daughters of an Irish Anglican clergyman. To be an Anglican in Ireland is to be the margin, because the Catholics are the main people, the majority. So Charlotte, Emily, and Anne were three of the five daughters. Two more sisters they had, but they died early because of poverty and lack of facilities. They had a brother named Branwell, but he later turned into an alcoholic and caused the sisters a lot of heart pain. The Brontes lived in Yorkshire in the village of Haworth, where their father was the parson. The Haworth Parsonage, you can visit there. It is the Bronte Museum now. And its surrounding moorland was the center of their children's lives. It is a very rustic place even now. And it is almost like a pilgrim center for literature enthusiasts. You can take long, long walks along the moors, you know, in Yorkshire now. Education was traumatic for the girls at the clergy daughter's school. They had poverty there. They didn't have enough facilities. They underwent a lot of trauma at this school. And this trauma is infused into their works also. For especially Jane Eyre, who studied in Lowood School, experiences more or less the same trauma. In 1842, Charlotte, Emily, the two sisters, traveled to Brussels in Belgium. And they returned less than a year later. They had gone to school there, where they worked as well as studied. And Charlotte eventually fell in love with the owner of that school, Constantin Hegger. Emily returned when her aunt was ailing and she died. And Emily did not go back. She also died very soon. Charlotte, however, went back. Emily is an enigmatic figure and her work is difficult to evaluate. Emily wrote poetry also. All the sisters wrote. Emily's poems are especially important. They are the Gondol poems. Many of the stories and poems that they wrote in their youth were about exotic imaginary places. Gondol poems, Angria, another place that she created. This is from the only existing picture of Charlotte, Emily, and Anne. This is the side of Anne's face. This is Emily Bronte. Look at that wild look, which you can see in Catherine's face as well. Now, an introduction to this magnificent novel. Wuthering Heights is Emily's only novel, published in 1847, the same year as Jane Eyre and Agnes Grey by Anne Bronte. Charlotte had asked her sisters to give one novel each. All of them had written one novel each. And before that, they had published their poems. And that was not really noticed by critics. Now they are publishing one novel each, all in the same year, 1847. Jane Eyre, and a few months later, Wuthering Heights, and then Agnes Grey. In the second edition that came after Emily Bronte's death, Charlotte Bronte added a preface. And Wuthering Heights was published under the pen name Ellis Bell. Carrer Bell, Ellis Bell, and Acton Bell. These were the pen names that the sisters used when they submitted their manuscripts to Smith, Elder & Co., the publisher. The novel rejects the conventions of the novel of the day. This novel, Wuthering Heights, as well as Jane Eyre before it, introduced the conventions of Romanticism. There is a wild hysterical tone in these, in especially Wuthering Heights. Passionate, vital heroine. Such a focus on the heroine, on hysteric passions, was quite unnatural in those days. Charlotte Bronte was even advised by Robert Southey to get married so that she will stop writing. Contemporary critics censured it for coarseness and brutality. They thought it is very indecent to show emotions in such a raw manner. Jane Eyre, however, is little less hysterical, and it was an instant success. The new critics of the early 20th century had a greater understanding of the work. In the 20th century, Wuthering Heights began to be really appreciated. Since then, this novel is held in greater regard than Jane Eyre itself. Wuthering Heights is considered to have greater power than Jane Eyre itself. The novel has 34 chapters and it is in 2 volumes. Even that is strange, because in those days, all novels had 3 volumes. Now let us take a quick look at the frame narrative of the novel. The novel has a double narrative, a double layered narrative with 2 narrators. As you all might know, Lockwood is listening to the story of Heathcliff and Catherine from Nellie Dean. So Lockwood is telling us the story, Nellie Dean is telling Lockwood the story. So double narrative. It has a story within a story structure. Or a Chinese box structure, or a Russian Matryoshka doll structure. It is Lockwood who runs Thrushcross Grange, who begins and ends the story. Nellie Dean tells much of the story to Lockwood. These two are the 2 narrators. As I told you, it has a Russian doll or Chinese box structure. Story within story within story. And the story is set in the Yorkshire Moors. The moors are marshlands where, if you do not know the place well, you might just fall into the marshy land and lose your life. Like the moors itself, the central characters and their relationships are tempestuous. The moors are wild, and anytime storms will break out. Like that, the passions of the characters in the novel are also tempestuous. The story is of intertwined destinies of 3 generations of the Earnshaws living at Wuthering Heights. The Earnshaws are living at Wuthering Heights. I told you, I showed you the farm that inspired Wuthering Heights, Top Withens. And the Lintons are living at Thrushcross Grange. The story of the intertwined destinies of the 3 generations of the Earnshaws and the Lintons. Now, the central theme of the novel is the unfulfilled, passionate relationship between Catherine Earnshaw and Heathcliff. It is a kind of forbidden love, because they grow up like brother and sister, and there is some class difference between the two. So this forbidden love is also unfulfilled and passionate between Catherine Earnshaw and Heathcliff. It leads to Heathcliff's revenge on the 2 families. The novel has unmistakably gothic elements. The opening of the novel is in the winter of 1801. Lockwood rents Thrushcross Grange, and his wealthy landlord Heathcliff lives at Wuthering Heights, which is the neighboring house 4 miles away. The wilderness around, or the stormy countryside around, is almost like a character. The wild, stormy countryside. The housekeeper Nellie Dean tells Lockwood the story of this relationship between Catherine and Heathcliff. Lockwood writes down her recollections, which form this novel. That is the frame narrative. I will give you more details of the frame narrative in the next few slides. So, volume 1, the opening word is 1801. The first word is 1801. It suggests a new beginning. It is like a diary entry. It sets up our expectations. The word 1801, the year, sets up our expectations of the historical specificity of a realistic narrative. We'll think that this is going to be like a historical novel. But it is far from a historical novel. It is a wild, romantic, even fantastic novel with supernatural elements, etc. Our expectations therefore remain unfulfilled as the narrative progresses. Mr. Lockwood is a new tenant of Thrushcross Grange, and he tells of his visit to Wuthering Heights. He tells us that he wanted to visit his landlord at Wuthering Heights, so he went there that evening, that afternoon. After the first day, Lockwood returns to the Heights the next afternoon. What happens there, we will hear. Before he returns, the household of Heathcliff, we are going to see now. Lockwood encounters his surly, unfriendly landlord and neighbor, Mr. Heathcliff. Don't think because he's neighbor, they are next door neighbors. He's like 4 miles away. Their house is 4 miles away. Heathcliff is found to be a surly, unfriendly landlord. He is rich also. He is like a dark-skinned gypsy in aspect. To see, he is like a dark-skinned gypsy. In dress and manners, he was a gentleman. Another person in that house is, in Wuthering Heights, is Joseph. Heathcliff's pious and surly old servant. He is also very ill-tempered, who speaks the Yorkshire accent. He's a rustic Yorkshire farmer. Hareton Earnshaw. Lockwood doesn't know who he is at first. He is an ignorant and impoverished young man. We will see who it is. And there is also a beautiful girl, Catherine Heathcliff, who turns out to be the widow of Heathcliff's dead son. At first, Lockwood doesn't know all these things. There is also Zilla, a female servant. So there are 5 people in that house when Lockwood visits the house. You can see Laurence Olivier in the 1939 movie, the famous movie Wuthering Heights of 1939. The world famous Hollywood actor Laurence Olivier. Lockwood has to spend the night there. When he reaches there, because it was too late to go back home. When he reaches there, Lockwood makes a number of mistakes. At first, he sees a bag of dead rabbits on the chair and he thinks they are cats. They were not cats. They were dead rabbits. And they're very, morbid. And he thinks Catherine is Heathcliff's wife and Hareton is his son. That is also a big mistake. And this reveals Lockwood as an unreliable narrator. Lockwood doesn't know for sure who these people are and he is making mistakes. He's an unreliable narrator. That is a technique in the novel. The rough weather forces Lockwood to spend the night there. He cannot go home, but he is not welcome there. Heathcliff does not even want him to stay there. But Zilla quietly, secretly leads him to a bedroom upstairs where no one is supposed to enter. It is like a ghost room, a haunted room. No one is supposed to enter there. And that happens to be the once upon a time bedroom of Heathcliff and Catherine when they were children. The bedroom. There is a wooden room within the room. Inside the room, there is a big cupboard-like contraption. And inside that cupboard-like contraption, there is a bed also. So there is a cupboard with books and also a bed, a wooden room within the room that doubles up as cabinet and table and bed. Lockwood finds several old books there. So this wooden room within the room is analogous to the story within the story of the novel. Lockwood finds several old books there, especially a book of sermons of one Reverend Jabes Branderham. Somebody, we don't know who it is. Some clergyman, Reverend Jabes Branderham, has written a book of sermons and that book is there. What is the peculiarity of the book? The margins of the book had been used as a childhood diary by Catherine Earnshaw, some girl. And that girl is the mother to the current Catherine that he met downstairs. He realizes that. And in the wooden cupboard, Catherine's name and Heathcliff's name are written in various combinations. Cathy Heathcliff, Catherine Heathcliff. Like the story within the story and the room within the room, these are text within text. It's an example of palimpsest. Text within text within text, the origin of which cannot be determined. Palimpsest in literary theory is a very important concept. Texts are intertextual and there are many texts within text and you can't identify the origin of a text. Looking at these pages, Lockwood learns about the childhood adventures of Heathcliff and the first Catherine. they seem to have been greatly friends and also in love with one another, with each other. And he also understands that Hindley, Catherine's brother, oppressed them, especially Heathcliff. That also is evident from the scribblings on the margins. So Lockwood falls into a restless sleep reading this book and gets two nightmares, one after the other. In the first dream, Lockwood and Joseph are going to hear Reverend James Branderham preach. And Lockwood reveals himself to be a sinner. You know why? Because he feels a kind of love for this Catherine whom he met downstairs. And he is feeling uneasy about it. That dream is not very important. After that first dream, he wakes because of a sound to see a tree branch rapping against the window. After the first dream, he wakes up to see a tree branch rapping against the window and making a noise. There is a storm happening outside. That is why he couldn't go home. And then again, he falls asleep. In the second dream, Lockwood tries to stop the branch from rapping. It is happening in the dream. And a child, he doesn't see the entire child, only the hand of the child. It must be the first Catherine Earnshaw. Her hand comes to the bedroom window and begs to be let in. He doesn't see things very clearly. She begs to be let in. Terrified, Lockwood scrapes the hand on the shards of glass. He moves the hand to, the hand gets hold of his hand and he moves it to and fro and the hand starts bleeding on the shards of glass. Lockwood wakes up screaming and that awakes Heathcliff. Heathcliff comes running. He is shocked to see that Lockwood has been put in this room because nobody is allowed to get into that room. And when Heathcliff understands what has happened, he is even more shocked. After Lockwood goes to the kitchen, Heathcliff opens the window and begs Catherine, his heart's darling, to come again. He has been waiting to see her for a long, long time. He never saw her. And now he's begging for her to come again in any form that she pleases. At sunrise, Heathcliff escorts Lockwood back to the Thrushcross Grange. And what is that famous line about the hand asking him to let him in? The intense horror of nightmare came over me. I tried to draw back my arm, but a hand clung to it, and the most melancholy voice sobbed, "Let me in, let me in." It's a very famous scene. The next day, Lockwood persuades the servant Nellie Dean to talk to him. At Thrushcross Grange, Lockwood persuades Nellie Dean to talk to him. Nellie tells him how she grew up as a child at Wuthering Heights. She was only like 12, 13 years old when she started working there at Wuthering Heights at Earnshaw's household. And one night, Earnshaw brought home a starving boy from Liverpool. He looked very dark and like a gypsy, whether it was Earnshaw's illegitimate son or who is it, nobody knows. Like this in Jane Eyre also, there is a girl, Adele Varens, without proper parentage. When Earnshaw went away to Liverpool, Finley had asked for a fiddle, Catherine had asked for a whip. He doesn't have either of these gifts. Instead, he brings this dark boy. And he names him Heathcliff after his own dead son. One son of Earnshaw had already died, called Heathcliff. That is why he names him Heathcliff. Mrs. Earnshaw is also there, but she is a very colorless, inefficient woman. And Mr. Earnshaw loves Heathcliff like his own son. Everyone else considered Heathcliff a gypsy brat. Mr. Earnshaw greatly favors Heathcliff to the dismay and anger and indignation of Hindley and Catherine. Hindley hates the new boy and considers him the cuckoo in the nest. Cuckoo in the nest. Nest of crows. Catherine also hates him first, but Heathcliff and the first Catherine become friends. Heathcliff and Catherine become friends very soon. Heathcliff's low social status and Earnshaw's love for him makes Hindley feel threatened and Catherine feel strengthened. Catherine joins up with this low-class boy. She's already the margin, being the woman, being the girl. Look at the psychology of Emily Bronte working out here. She's already the girl and marginal. So she pals up with the marginal boy and she feels strengthened by the friendship. Whereas Hindley feels threatened. Hindley starts ill-treating Heathcliff. Once all the children fall ill with measles, Heathcliff stoically suffers. He is very patient and stoic. He doesn't give way to emotion and complaining. And Nellie becomes fond of Heathcliff because Heathcliff is such a good patient. Hindley is old enough to go to college. He's sent off to college at this time. And Mr. Earnshaw dies in his absence. After Mr. Earnshaw's death, Hindley returns with a wife, Frances. Hindley comes home with a wife called Frances. Frances is poor and perpetually ill. She's very unhealthy and ill and rather silly also. Frances is rather silly and poor and ill, always ill. Hindley becomes master of Wuthering Heights and turns Heathcliff into a servant. He has to work in the fields, sleep with the servants. Heathcliff is angry with Hindley. But Catherine and Heathcliff grow more closer by this time and more mischievous. They keep wandering the moors and spending time together. Their favorite pastime is to wander the moors. Once they visit Thrushcross Grange, which is 4 miles away. They are rather contemptuous of the Lintons, the children living at Thrushcross Grange. Thrushcross Grange has a proper mother, so there is order there, discipline there. The children are well taken care of. Whereas Catherine and Heathcliff are wild children. They make fun of Linton and Edgar Linton and his sister Isabella. They look in through the window to see how well-dressed and well-fed they are and so disciplined. They make fun of them and they are caught. At first, the Lintons at Thrushcross Grange, the people there, do not understand who these children are. And then they realize these are neighbors. Edgar and Isabella Linton are the petted things at the Grange. While they are there, Catherine is bitten by a bulldog and she has to stay at the Grange for 5 weeks. That is how they are caught. So she is ill and she is staying at the Grange for 5 weeks. Because at that time, Mrs. Earnshaw is no more. Hindley, meanwhile, forbids Heathcliff to have further contact with Catherine. Heathcliff comes back home and Hindley tells Heathcliff that he comes back to Wuthering Heights and Hindley tells Heathcliff that he should have no further contact with Catherine. But then Catherine herself comes back from Thrushcross Grange. When she comes back, she is much changed. Catherine has much changed. She now dresses and acts like a lady. Now she has seen how ladies are. Mrs. Linton has taught her how to behave, how to have table manners, how to dress. And Catherine wants to be like that. Now she behaves like a Linton. And she has befriended Edgar and Isabella. She is now friends with Edgar and Isabella. Catherine's love for Heathcliff has not changed. But Heathcliff feels inferior and neglected. Heathcliff feels threatened. Heathcliff is not happy with Catherine's change. And Catherine feels torn between her loyalty to Heathcliff and her attraction to her new companions. She is attracted to the life of the Lintons. At the same time, she feels loyal to her old friend Heathcliff. She loves Heathcliff, but she wants to live like the Lintons. Hindley and Edgar joined to humiliate Heathcliff. Hindley, Catherine's brother, and Edgar, Catherine's new friend, join to humiliate Heathcliff. Let us stop the story there and go into some analysis. Thrushcross Grange and Wuthering Heights are like two extremes and they are two symbols. Throughout the novel, both these houses are confining spaces as against the wild openness and freedom of the moors. Both these houses are confining spaces. People are trapped there, kind of. Wuthering Heights represents rough, indisciplined and wild spirit. Their mother is eventually dead. Mrs. Earnshaw is dead. And the absence of the mother signifies indiscipline and wilderness. Wuthering Heights represents storm and nature. Thrushcross Grange, on the other hand, is precisely the opposite. Thrushcross Grange is splendid, cultivated. It has a civilized atmosphere. And it has the presence of the mother, that's why. And it represents calm and culture. The firm status of the landed gentry is what it means, as opposed to the savage wilderness of Wuthering Heights. And while Catherine does not willingly enter the Grange, she is, remember, captured in a fairy tale manner. She is wild, untamed. She wouldn't willingly enter the Grange. But once she enters, there is no escape. Until death, she cannot leave. She escapes only by death. The image of the two civilized children inside the house and the two wild children outside the window is significant. Inside and outside. This is Ponden Hall today. It is a contemporary picture. It is considered to be the model for Thrushcross Grange. This looks less wild than Wuthering Heights. Now, young Heathcliff comes back to Wuthering Heights from Thrushcross Grange, leaving Catherine there, and tells Nelly about their escapade at the Grange. It was in that moment that he says his first major speech. He tells Nelly about how he would never want to be there in Thrushcross Grange. I would not exchange for 1,000 lives my condition there for Edgar Linton's at Thrushcross Grange. Not if I might have the privilege of flinging Joseph off the highest gable and painting the house front with Hindley's blood. Oh, what a violent speech. The first speech of the young boy Heathcliff. Heathcliff's language is different from that of the others. It is more natural and violent, expressive, emotional, powerful. He admires the beauty of the Grange, but prefers the freedom of his life with Catherine. He will not want the confinement of the Grange. When would you catch me wishing to have what Catherine wanted? When would you catch me wishing to have what Catherine wanted? He asked Nelly. You can see Catherine and Heathcliff wandering in the moors. This is from the movie, 1939. When you study classics, look up in the internet which are the most famous adaptations of these movies. They might be available in YouTube or somewhere else. At least clippings will be there. Expose yourself to all that. Hindley's wife, Frances, gives birth to a son, Hareton. That is the Hareton that you saw at the beginning with Lockwood. And Frances dies of consumption, tuberculosis. That is why she was perpetually ill. Hindley is alone. He starts drinking, becomes even more tyrannical to Heathcliff. At that time, Edgar proposes to Catherine. Edgar proposes to Catherine. And Catherine accepts. Because she wants to live that life. She thinks marriage is different from real love that she has for Heathcliff. She tells Nelly that she would never have done so if her brother had not turned Heathcliff into someone it would disgrace her to marry. She's very straightforward. her feelings are natural. She doesn't hide her feelings. Hindley had turned Heathcliff into a mere slave, and Catherine does not want to marry a slave like Heathcliff. That is why she wants to marry Edgar. Heathcliff overhears her talking to Nelly. He overhears this comment and he leaves without Catherine knowing. Immediately he leaves. He doesn't stay and listen to the rest of the conversation. This is a very famous conversation that Catherine is having with Nelly. Heathcliff hears only part of it. Misunderstands that Catherine doesn't want him or like him and love him anymore, and leaves the house. He does not hear her explain to Nelly the depth of her feelings for Heathcliff. Her speech is very important in the novel. It reveals a major concern of the novel, which is the nature of love. What is the nature of love? That is the major concern of the novel. Let us come to that point. Let us look at that excerpt. Catherine is telling Nelly, "I cannot express it, but surely you and everybody have a notion that there is, or should be, an existence of yours beyond you. There must be us beyond us." That is what Catherine means. We don't end up in this body. We have extensions in other people. "What were the use of my creation if it were entirely contained here in this body? My great miseries in this world have been Heathcliff's miseries. And I watched and felt each from the beginning. We grew up together, Nelly. My miseries have been Heathcliff's miseries, and Heathcliff's have been mine. My great thought in living is himself. Why I'm living is because of him. He is me. He is my life. If all else perished and he remained, I should still continue to be. If everything in this world, including me, perished and only he remained, that would mean I am still alive. But if all else remained and he were annihilated, the universe would turn into a mighty stranger. If everything else remained but he died, what is the use of living then? The universe would turn into a mighty stranger. I should not seem a part of it." And then she says the famous lines, "My love for Linton is like the foliage in the woods. The trees will shed their leaves in winter. My love is like that. My love for Linton is like the foliage in the woods. Time will change it. I'm well aware, as winter changes the trees. My love for Heathcliff resembles the eternal rocks beneath. A source of little visible delight, but necessary. My love for Heathcliff does not change, Nelly. It is there forever. Nelly, I am Heathcliff. He is always, always in my mind, not as a pleasure, any more than I am always a pleasure to myself. But he's there as my own being. So do not talk of our separation again." What deep love. Gives me goosebumps. Such unchanging love. And it never changes until her last moment, her last breath. And then Heathcliff has gone away. After some time, this is Linton. Linton and Catherine marry. It is after the marriage that Heathcliff returns and begins his revenge. 3 years later, Catherine and Edgar are married. Their life at first is simple and happy. Heathcliff returns mysteriously wealthy and educated. Again, a mystery in the novel, unexplained. He is mysteriously wealthy and educated. And he begins to live at Thrushcross Grange with Hindley. Hindley is in a very bad shape now. He's a drunkard with no money. And Heathcliff gambles with Hindley and gets all his possessions, starts lending him money. Thus, Hindley becomes indebted to Heathcliff. Heathcliff also starts meeting Catherine. He cannot avoid meeting Catherine. She's overjoyed, and Edgar is annoyed. Edgar's sister Isabella begins to love Heathcliff. She realizes that Heathcliff is very different from her brother, and she does not heed repeated warnings from Catherine. Catherine warns her because, not because she's jealous, but because Catherine knows that Heathcliff is incapable of loving anybody but herself. Heathcliff cannot love Catherine. She knows that. Isabella will only suffer. But Isabella tells Catherine, "I love him more than you ever loved Edgar." It's true. Catherine never really loved Edgar. With an eye on Isabella's inheritance, because Heathcliff wants to possess both the houses. So with an eye on Isabella's inheritance, Heathcliff encourages her love, even though he doesn't have a small iota of love even for Isabella. One day, a fight ensues between Edgar and Heathcliff when Heathcliff comes to visit Catherine. Edgar doesn't like it, and Edgar and Heathcliff start fighting. This breaks Catherine's heart. Catherine becomes seriously upset because the two men in her life are fighting for no reason. Why can't they understand that their role in her life are two separate roles? They don't overlap. Heathcliff is banished from the grange by Edgar. To punish Edgar, heartbroken Catherine refuses to eat for 3 days. She is very ziddi, very adamant. And for 3 days, in order to teach them a lesson, she doesn't eat and finally falls ill. Edgar nurses her back to a fragile state of health. She is very weak. Isabella and Heathcliff, meanwhile, elope. They run away. Much to Edgar's frustration and anger. Edgar hates Heathcliff and he will never forgive her. Isabella, he will never forgive her. And Heathcliff is cruel to Isabella. He ill-treats Isabella. Very soon, Isabella begins to regret her marriage. She realizes that she has made a mistake, but her brother would not listen to her. Edgar refuses to forgive her. She writes a letter to Nelly, telling her of a miserable life at Wuthering Heights, begging Nelly to visit. She wants to meet Nelly. When Nelly finally visits, Heathcliff requests a meeting with Catherine. Heathcliff sees Nelly and asks Nelly to let him meet Catherine. Nelly knows the love between Catherine and Heathcliff, and she cannot refuse. At that time, Catherine is pregnant and bedridden. Nelly and Edgar had not at first taken her illness seriously. She never recovered. At first, they didn't take her illness seriously, but she was actually dying of brain fever. She had a very serious illness of the brain. And this drove her mad. One day in her madness, she plucks out feathers from her pillow. This madness is analogous to the madness of Bertha Rochester. Madness that is the result of circumstances. Her madness has been analyzed by psychoanalytic critics. Like Bertha Rochester's madness also has been analyzed. While Edgar is away, Heathcliff comes to the grange and sees Catherine for the last time. It is the last time, he doesn't know, but she is dying and she will die soon after this. When they meet, they kiss and embrace. Catherine is very weak and dying. You can see the scene from the 1939 movie. "Oh, Kathy. Oh, my life, how can I bear it?" was the first sentence he uttered. And she replies, "You and Edgar have broken my heart, Heathcliff. And you both come to bewail the deed to me, as if you were the people to be pitied. I shall not pity you, not I. You have killed me, and thriven on it, I think. How strong you are. How many years do you mean to live after I'm gone?" Kathy is making fun of Heathcliff. Heathcliff had knelt on one knee to embrace her. as you saw in the picture. Now he attempts to rise because he does not want to hear all this and quarrel. But she seized his hair and kept him down. "I wish I could hold you," she continued bitterly, "till we were both dead. I shouldn't care what you suffered. I care nothing for your sufferings. Why shouldn't you suffer? I do. Will you forget me? Will you be happy when I'm in the earth? Will you say 20 years hence, that is the grave of Catherine Earnshaw? I loved her years ago and was wretched to lose her, but it's past. I have loved many others since. Will you say all this, Heathcliff? I have loved many others since. My children are dearer to me than she was. And at my death, I shall not rejoice that I am going to her. I shall be sorry that I must leave them. Oh, will you say so, Heathcliff? Don't torture me till I'm as mad as yourself," cried he, wrenching his head free and grinding his teeth. "Are you possessed with the devil?" he pursued savagely. "To talk in that manner to me when you're dying? Do you reflect that all those words will be branded in my memory and eating deeper eternally after you have left me? These last words you tell me, do you realize I'll never forget them? And still you tell me such words, Catherine. You know you lied to say I have killed you. And Catherine, you know that I could as soon forget you as my existence. Is it not sufficient for your eternal selfishness that while you're at peace, I shall writhe in the torments of hell?" "I shall not be at peace," moaned Catherine. Heathcliff continues, "You teach me now how cruel you have been, cruel and false. Why did you despise me? Why did you betray your own heart, Cathy, and why did you go and marry that man Linton, Edgar Linton? I have not one word of comfort. You deserve this. You left me, and you have killed yourself. Yes, you may kiss me and cry, and wring out my tears and kisses. My tears will blight you. They'll damn you. You loved me. Then what right had you to leave me? What right? Answer me. For the poor fancy you felt for Linton? Because misery and degradation and death and nothing that God or Satan could inflict would have parted us. Nothing in this world would have parted us. The only thing that could have parted us is you. You of your own will did it. Only you could have parted us, and you parted us. I have not broken your heart. You have broken it. And in breaking it, you have broken mine. So much the worse for me that I'm strong. Do I want to live? What kind of living will it be when you, oh God, would you like to live with your soul in the grave? Heathcliff cannot bear it. "Let me alone, let me alone," sobbed Catherine. "If I have done wrong, I'm dying for it. It's enough. You left me too, but I won't upbraid you. I forgive you. Forgive me. It's hard to forgive," says Heathcliff. "It's hard to forgive. To look at those eyes and feel those wasted hands," he answered. "Kiss me again, and don't let me see your eyes. I forgive what you have done to me. I love my murderer.
but yours. You have killed yourself. You're dying. You're going because of what you did. How can I forgive your murderer, Catherine? Afterwards, Catherine dies. Not that day, in a few days. That day, what happened was, Edgar enters and finds Heathcliff embracing Catherine. She was unconscious by then. And Catherine dies soon after. She never fully regains consciousness. 2 hours before her death, she gives birth to a daughter, 2 months prematurely. Hindley is invited for the funeral, but Isabella is not. Edgar will never forgive her. Edgar and Heathcliff both grieve because both these men loved her. They both grieve. Heathcliff begs her ghost to haunt him, to remain on this earth in any form. "May she wake in torment," he cried, with frightful vehemence, stamping his foot and groaning in a sudden paroxysm of ungovernable passion. "Why, she's a liar to the end. Where is she? Not there, not in heaven, not perished. Where? Oh, you said you cared nothing for my sufferings. And I pray one prayer. I repeat it till my tongue stiffens. Catherine Earnshaw, may you not rest as long as I'm living. You said I killed you. Haunt me. Haunt me then. The murderers do haunt their the murdered do haunt their murderers, I believe. I know that ghosts have wandered on earth. Be with me always. Take any form. Drive me mad. Only do not leave me in this abyss where I cannot find you. Oh God, it's unutterable. I cannot live without my life. I cannot live without my soul." Some days later, Isabella flees from Wuthering Heights and appears at the Grange. She has left Heathcliff. From the Grange, she leaves for Gimmerton, the nearby town, and then to London to escape Heathcliff. There in London, she gives birth to a sickly boy, Linton. Soon, Hindley dies. Now there are 2 boys, Hareton and Linton. Nelly warns Edgar to care for Hindley's son, Hareton. Heathcliff vows that if they take Hareton with him, if Edgar takes Hareton from him, he will take his child, Linton, from Isabella and torture him. Hareton is denied education by Heathcliff, and Hareton learns to use bad language. Hareton is like a mirror image of Heathcliff. Heathcliff wants Hareton to suffer in the same way that he suffered. And he wants to see if Hareton will stand the same taunts and insults. Hareton is like a mirror image of young Heathcliff. 12 years later, Isabella dies. 12 years pass. Linton is now 12 years old. Edgar brings sickly Linton home. Immediately, Heathcliff takes his son away. He reveals to Nelly his plan to see his child ruling over both Thrushcross Grange and Wuthering Heights. Whether it will be possible is not very clear because his son Linton is very sickly.